old, and then sent into hell, sent into Nandi. And then this tracking of, I'll just call it in very simple language, the problem of the pigeon. So this also in between this nowhere, non-placed place of no natality, no reference to origin, and so on. And then this motif with train also, etc. So very, very light reference on that side. Let me see if I can invite you, see if I can get you to meditate on that. But maybe the last 5 or 6 years, I have been sort of obsessed with one composition performance by Cecil Taylor. Can't seem to stop listening. It's interminable. His recording from 1974, Silent Tongues. And it's all about finding the poetics, if you will, using the poetics to inhabit this abyss and to remain there. I think I want to invite, on the one hand, any reflections or thoughts musically, poetically, philosophically in this tree. And then to introduce a sort of other question in relation to it, and that's the relation of spatiality and temporality. Silent Tongues refers to spatiality in a sense, but it never names it except as the abyss. It's all about movement. It's all about tracking, having no markers, no references, no origin, no location or telos. And yet at the same time, music as a form produces a temporality. It has a kind of spatial duration. So in the experience of listening to this last piece, in the experience of listening to Silent Tongues, you know, again and again and again, this space opens up and this duration that you can't really decide where you are opens up. And I'm wondering about that as I don't want to say reference, but I guess I have to say there's some way to talk about a practice, a poetic practice, a discursive practice, a reflective practice, a conversational practice, and so forth. And so any meditation, this is the stuff.
Well, I mean, just thinking about Cecil, who, you know, I don't want anybody to think I mean any disrespect when I refer to him as Cecil. It's just this, it's actually, it's just because, you know, because he lives in my house, you know, in a certain, you know what I mean, in my head. But in some ways, what I'm thinking of is precisely that this kind of familiarity, in a way that invokes kinship but moves beyond that. The kind of familiarity that disrupts normative conceptions of family, you know, and how that manifests itself with regard to the sociality, the social spaces within which the music gets made. And for me, the making of music is inseparable from the making of that space, but also the making of, or the making of those places, I guess would be better, but also the making of time. So what we're talking about is something like the ongoing process by which music and place and time are being made within the context of an ongoing disruption of the givenness of space-time, the givenness of the field within which a very restrictive and a deeply exclusionary notion of contemporaneity would manifest itself, to use in Frank's language, right? And again, I remember reading this essay by Spivak in which she refers in this kind of tongue-in-cheek way to what she calls to Kantian honesty. She talks about the Kantian honesty, right? And there is something honest about the fact that he at least lets you know from the very beginning that the transcendental aesthetic of space-time is something that has to be posited. That it moves by way of a kind of an imaginative leap, which he immediately wants to drastically restrict and criminalize, right? Unregulate. But the necessity of that leap, that what it is that we posit as the given is not given. At one point in this book that I'm trying to finish, I think I say something like, what's continually given is that the given is not the given, right? That this is, so if you think about that in terms, that's why I'm trying to take when I'm talking about the music as a place where time is made. And this operates at the level, again, not only of the internal place, the interiority, so to speak, of Cecil's music, of his compositional language, of his compositional structures, of his improvisational relations with the other people in the band, but also at the level of the relationship between the band and the audience within a framework that we could talk about under the rubric of the intramural in Spillers' language, and in ways that Jared Sexton talks about, I think, in this really brilliant way, there's a moment in the, I don't know if you've seen, he kind of combines the social life of social death with this other piece that I can't think of the name of, but in this lecture that he gave at Berkeley, in the Q&A session is like amazing. He's talking about this moment